My name is Peter Davison. I played the Fifth Doctor, and you're listening to the Five-ish Fangirls.
Five-ish Fangirls, I love you, and I'm one of the Five-ish. In fact, I'm the biggest one of the Five-ish. I am the Sixth Doctor, Colin Baker, and I wish you all well. Have fun.
Hello. I just want to say hello to the Five-ish Fangirls. No, that's wrong. I want to say hello to the Five-ish Fangirls. Yes, that's right.
Yes.
Yes, that's yes. Correct. That's anyway, true. Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Hello. Hello. Hello. Hello. That's five hellos to the five fish-ish fangirls. Bye.
This is Paul McGann, and you're listening to the Five-ish Fangirls podcast.
The Ted is a squeak continue all the way to episode 254 of the Five-ish Fangirls podcast. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear doctor. Happy birthday, Doctor Who. Yeah, thought you were done with me singing. Welcome everyone to this week's episode of the Five-ish Fangirls podcast. So glad you could join us. Let's start off like you're doing from the virtual table and see who's joined us this week.
This is Brittany in Bethlehem.
This is Chrissy under a pile of snow in Salt Lake City.
This is Holly from Wisconsin in the soon-to-be snow-covered Wisconsin.
And this is Rachel, and this is Indiana, so I could have snow tomorrow, and it could be 80 the day after, so who knows.
Sounds about right with me, too.
Yep. Oh, you people out west with your seasons!
You can't see me, but I'm just doing the little shruggy thing.
Yeah.
Nice intro, like, Rachel. I was about ready to. I can't pull the Marilyn and do the breathy.
Thankfully, that song is not copywritten anymore. So,
yeah,
no, indeed. So, stick it, YouTube.
Anyway, so
just as long as we don't get sucked into the vortex, we're good.
Yeah. Yeah. So let's do the news, which we don't really have a lot of news, and what news we have is pertinent to this week's topic. So today, this week's gonna be very Doctor Who heavy. So
hey, I'm fine.
Y'all in grab your jelly babies and your jammy dodgers and your
bow ties,
fish fingers and custard, and sit back and relax. So
yep. We're going back to the space year of 2013.
Yeah,
and a few others in there.
Yeah. But first, we got to look a little forward with after some teasing and some more teasing. The BBC has finally dropped a trailer for season 12, so Jodie Whittaker's second season as the Doctor, which will be, we don't have an exact date yet, so we still don't know when Easter Saturday is going to be. There's been rumors swirling that's going to come back on New Year's Day, but that they haven't, nothing official. So I am holding my breath on that one, especially because New Year's Day is smack dab in the middle of the week. That would be kind of weird. I don't think Doctor Who's going to move to Wednesdays or anything. So,
yeah, it's one thing when they have like the Christmas or New Year's Day special, and it's Christmas, New Year's, whatever. Yeah. But for the actual series, no, not so much.
Yeah. But yeah, so we do have a trailer, and we get to see, you know, the Doctor and the gang, the fam, off on new adventures, including some familiar returning faces, some we knew about, like the Jadoon, the platoon of Jadoon, not on the moon, I don't think. we're going to see the return of the Cybermen. And I have not seen confirmation, but it looks like maybe the Rachnos.
I think so, because that looks like that one shot definitely looks like it.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's a different color, kind of, but the style is.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's very arachnose-esque.
Maybe it's a different, I don't know, race? I don't know.
Or maybe it's...
We've only seen them that one special, right?
Yeah. Yeah. So they're... Yep. That was the queen, so maybe the not queens are different.
Maybe this is baby.
That could be.
Maybe they didn't all drown.
Mm-hmm. Donna! We need Donna. Yeah, really?
Yeah. Oh, and then we've...
Yeah. Starch.
Yeah. And then we've got some special guests that will be in season 12, which most of them, I have no idea who they are because they're probably people that are famous in the UK and have not made their way over here, but I believe most everybody knows Stephen Fry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. One of, absolutely.
Yeah.
I could hear Glenn fanboying out from here practically when that was announced. So there you go.
Now I gotta start a petition though, because now we've got Stephen Fry, now we need to get Hugh Laurie.
Exactly. Oh my goodness.
Fry and Laurie.
Yes.
So. Mm-hmm. So it looks like it's gonna be fun. So
yeah.
We'll still have to wait and see when exactly Doctor Who is coming back, but it sounds like it's gonna be sooner rather than later.
Yeah, they said early 2020, which
does that narrows it down, but not that specifically.
Yeah, when I think early, I think like January, February.
Yeah.
Maybe March. I don't know.
Maybe
when does Easter fall this year? Is it
good
in March
question.
Or April?
Well, let me look that up. My phone will tell me. Looks like April.
Easter Saturday.
Yeah, April 12th.
Yeah, April 12th. That's still considered early.
Yeah,
I don't know.
Maybe Easter Saturday. We'll see. Sean's got his sign. Easter Saturday. Easter Saturday. The little asterisk and the small print at the bottom. Easter Saturday might not actually fall on Easter Saturday. So, yeah. That's really it for the news. So, I do want to give a quick recap of my little adventure over the weekend, since it was only a single day, which is unusual for me. But this was kind of a last minute. I think I decided last week ish. To actually go to this convention. This was not one that was been on my radar. This is GalaxyCon Louisville, which used to be called Louisville SuperCon, I think. And then I think they're under new management because I think GalaxyCon is like a bigger company that owns several conventions with that label, kind of like Wizard World, I think. I haven't actually done the research, so I don't know. But that's what it sounds like to me. This convention was not even on my radar. By the time we get to this time of year, I'm like, I'm done. You know, I'm just gonna lay low and, you know, save my pennies because Christmas is coming up. And, you know, chill and avoid con crud until the season kicks off again next year. That was going to be the case until they announced Christopher Eccleston as one of the guests for this convention. And I was like, okay, well, this may need to happen. So, and then they announced it was Christopher Eccleston and Catherine Tate. And then Catherine canceled several weeks ago, unfortunately, due to scheduling issues. But Chris was still on the guest list, and so was Dave Bautista, who we all mostly know as Drax from the Marvel Cinematic Universe. But especially, you know, Chris, that's a big deal because Chris has just started doing conventions, like in the last year or so, and he's only done, I don't know if he's really done any in the U.S. yet. I know he's going to be at Gallifrey 1, but that's not till next year. But I don't think he's really done a lot of U.S. conventions.
Good luck getting tickets.
He was, he was at New York.
Was he?
Yeah. Okay. I remember being like, man, I couldn't go.
Yeah. So it was one of those where it's like, yeah, it's like the odds of our paths crossing again soonish are very slim. The way it was scheduled is it's a 3-day convention. It's Friday, Saturday, Sunday. But Chris and Bautista were only there on Saturday. So I was like, okay, well, I could drive to Louisville for the day and I don't have to worry about a hotel or anything. I'll just go for the Saturday, which is always the busiest, but what are you going to do? And go see these two, and that'll be a thing that I'll do. So that's what I did. So I got up bright and early. Well, it was early, not so much bright because it rained all day on Saturday. Wet and early Saturday morning, and drove to Louisville, which thankfully from Indianapolis is a real easy drive, straight down 65 until you see the river. Just go south till you see the river, and there it is. And I managed to park in a parking garage that was literally across the street from the convention center and happened to be across the street from the door that they were using.
Even better.
To get into the convention center. They were only letting people in a certain entrance. So that was really nice. So I parked and went and got my wristband, and thankfully the lines were not long. I was able to walk right up and, you know, confirm my admission, and gave me my wristband. The wristbands are really nice, by the way. These are not like those paper bands that get all crumpled within like an hour. Like, these are like, I don't know, they're like a heavy duty, like vinyl plastic with like this holographic like sheen to it. They're really nice wristbands. So they get points right there. Their convention center is really nice too. So they get some points here. This was a brand new con to me. I'd never been to anything in at their convention center before in Louisville, so I had no idea really what I was in for. So I went and got in line to wait for the expo vendor hall to open at 10, and really try to make sure that it's not like you're just stuck standing and waiting. They've got food vendors scattered throughout the place, like they're like kiosks type things with different stuff you could buy food wise. They had one that was like specifically just ice cream. They had a couple of bars set up, like cash bars, so you could buy alcohol if you wanted to. They had a DJ. They had a DJ set up right outside the doors of the vendor hall, and was there the entire day just playing music. So there was always music playing, which that was pretty cool. They had a designated like cosplay area where they had backdrops set up so people could take photos. There was one that was like a fantasy like forest backdrop. They had one that was the TARDIS interior. It was like Matt Smith's, the towards his end of the run console room as a backdrop. They had a TARDIS that you could take photos with. So that was pretty awesome. And then they had a designated kids area as well, with lots of tables and activities for the kids to do. And those were outside of the vendor hall. So it was a good use of space, because the way they're convention center is laid out, their main hall is actually on the second floor, So, but they have like these big areas, these big walkways, and then these areas up against, like in the corner of the building, and this big enough space that you could just put a bunch of tables and signage and stuff and have like designated spots. Like cosplayers go here, kids go here. And you didn't have to worry about being stuck in the chaos that is the vendor hall. As soon as the vendor hall opened, I hightailed it over to where all the celebrities were. And if I'd thought about it more, I probably should have reversed what I did, but all things considering, I think it worked out well for me anyway. Because what I did is I got in Chris's line for his table, even though Bautista and Chris were right next to each other, which Bautista was in a corner and then Chris was right next to him. To the left, and then to the left of Chris's table actually was George Takei.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. it was like Bautista going from left to, or from right to left. It was Bautista, Christopher Eccleston, George Takei, John Cusack, and then Carrie Elwes.
Oh, man.
Inconceivable.
Which I don't know if somebody knows the answer to this. I don't know if this is like a, if this is just a quirky like Hollywood thing, or there's like some more logic to this. But Carrie Elwes, he was at Indiana Comic Con several years ago. They did this when he was at this too. He's not out where people can see him. They put up curtains.
Yeah, they did that when he was here at Salt Lake. I think, if I remember right, I think they said because it's he likes to talk to people, like more one-on-one sort of a thing. And he really, like he doesn't want to like be rushed, I guess. Or that's what I've heard. That was the explanation they gave when he was here in Salt Lake.
Yeah.
But she was here twice and both times did the same thing for him.
Yeah. But it was just, I didn't realize that he was there until I walked by and saw the sign and saw people waiting outside this curtain. And then occasionally they would let someone in, like the Wizard of Oz or something, or like, come have your fortune told by, you know, Carrie Elwes.
And I think they might also do photo ops back there. I don't know. That's what I was told.
Okay.
When he was here.
I mean, if that's the case, that's kind of cool, actually.
Yeah.
So it allows you to get rid of any outside distractions. So
yeah, you don't have all the people.
Yeah.
You know.
All the noise and people trying to take pictures over people's heads and. So, but that was an interesting row. of people to be in, because most everybody else, like if they were from the same like fandom or whatever, they had them together, so they had like all the other Star Trek people, like they had people from Deep Space Nine and TNG, they were all in a row together. They had like all the anime voiceover people together, but just that row that we that I needed to go to. It was like, that's an interesting collection of people.
Maybe they don't consider the original series Star Trek the same as the others. I don't know.
it may be just because they, part of it, I'm sure, is what makes sense as far as where, you know, if people are fans of a certain franchise, then, you know, it makes it easier for them if they could just go down the line, go bam, 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 for the most part. But then I'm sure crowd control has some to do with it, too. It's like,
I'm
if we put this person here, we can expect a certain crowd level. So we need to be able to control the crowds. Like, Bautista had a line all day. Pretty much at least when I was there, he had a line all day. Chris, not so much. His ebbed and flowed. George would have a line when he was at his table. I never saw John Cusack at his table, so I don't know what kind of lines he had when he was there. And then across in that same section, if I was looking at, Christopher Eccleston's table, behind us was what's his face from Mystery Science Theater, the new one, and Felicia Day and some other people. And Felicia always had a line. The other guy didn't. I felt kind of bad for him. So I got right in line for Chris at his table. He had a photo op right away. He was scheduled to be at his table after that. And then Bautista actually had his panel first thing. So he was scheduled to be at his table after that. So, but I was really far up in the line, at least as far as the regular people. They had a separate line for the people that or had like the VIP type badges, where they had their own shorter designated line they could get in. So when Chris showed up, like I was right there and everybody's like, yay! Got through the line, got the autograph, got to say hi to him, and he was super nice. I'm not an expert by any means, but there's just part of his, like, he seemed genuinely happy to be there. Like, he was talking with people and shaking hands and, answering questions and that sort of thing. But you could just kind of tell that he's definitely new to the whole convention thing. Mm-hmm. And he'll get better as he does more of them. I think he'll get more comfortable, not better, but more comfortable. But you could just kind of tell that he was like, this is kind of,
it's new to him.
It's kind of crazy. All these people are here and they want to see me and they want to pay for my signature on something. Like, this is wild.
Yeah.
And
you know what? I'm like, he's making the effort and he's kind of, he's come around and I think that's awesome that he's like really, he's kind of getting more into it and going to conventions. And I really hope he comes out my direction because I really want to meet him.
Yeah, he probably will eventually. So, but you can just kind of tell, you can tell who's been doing like the convention circuit for a while and knows how this goes and knows, like, how to work the crowd and that sort of thing. And Chris was just like, I was like, ah, you poor sweet baby deer, you're so new to this. It's like, you'll get used to it.
Like, give it time.
Yeah,
we're just happy you're here, man.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. So I got Chris's autograph. And then I went and got in the ginormous line for Bautista, and proceeded to wait, and the line would slowly move and very slowly move and very slowly move. And I don't know if it was just the sheer number of people that was causing it to go so slow, because apparently Bautista is not much of a talker. So it wasn't like he was just chatting with people. Although by the time I got up there, he would chat with people for, a minute or so. Not like drawn on conversations like some others do. But, it's not like he was completely ignoring and not talking to people. But I think it was just a sheer number of people. And then there was a lot of VIPs, too. So they get priority over us non-VIP folk. So it's like I waited and the line would slowly move and slowly move and slowly move. And eventually he was scheduled to leave to go to a photo op and wasn't scheduled to be back at his table for like an hour and a half because he, I guess, would have like his designated lunch break after that. And I was hungry too at that point. So I abandoned ship because there was no way I was going to get to him before he left. And it's like, he's going to be gone for an hour and a half, and I'm hungry. So it's like, we'll try again after lunch.
When draft seats, you eat.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So I left, and thankfully, because I was parked so close, I was able to go back to my car, drop off some stuff, and I brought food and was able to, like, go and sequester myself in my car for, like, a half an hour and charge my phone and eat and, like, decompress, because by that point I'd been in large crowds of people for several hours. So that was nice. And so then I went back, and it was still not time for Bautista to be back yet. So I went to, they have designated cosplay meetups, like, built into their schedule, which is really cool. So in that designated cosplay area, they had scheduled for, like, different fandoms. So it was like, you know, all the anime people meet at this time and all the DC cosplayers meet at this time. So there happened to be a Doctor Who cosplay meetup. So I went over there, and one of the convention people was like, well, let's get everybody here in front of this backdrop and I'll take pictures. It's like, we'll put it on our Facebook page. So they did pictures in front of the backdrop and then with the TARDIS and different combinations, like all the doctors, all the companions, and like doctors with their companions, and, you know, like all the Rose cosplayers together and all the River cosplayers together. So that was pretty cool that they, like, actually do that, like, official, and, you know, have somebody who works the con there to take pictures so that they can go up on their social media, so that you can go to, like, their Facebook page later and find those pictures. So that was pretty cool. So then I went back, got back in line for Bautista again, and waited, and waited, and waited, and waited. And, you know, I'd be chatting with people that were in line, and I had a book, and I was chatting with you guys on Facebook Messenger, and texting Chauncey, and, you know, just kind of people watching, because it was kind of nice, because where Bautista was located, where the line was, we were up against this wall that went by most of the celebrity area. So as the line moved, I could, like, see down tables and stuff, and, you know, celebrity watch and people watch. It also happened to be right where the area was that they were using for the celebrities to go backstage to, like, the green room, where they could go and get food and go to the bathroom and, you know, do whatever. So, you know, I'd be, like, standing there just kind of chilling, and then I'd hear an excuse me, and it's Chris Sarandon needing to cut through so he can get by. I'm like, okay, Prince Humperdinck, sure, go right on ahead. Don't mind me.
I won't boo you.
Yeah. Like, Humperdinck, 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 Humperdinck. And, like, Michael Dorn, Worf from Star Trek, would walk by, or Terry Farrell, who played Drex, or Dax on Deep Space Nine, would walk by, and she's not aged since she was on Deep Space Nine. No one's gorgeous. cosplayers would come by, and people would, you know, stop them and ask for pictures, and at one point Lou Ferrigno scared the bejesus out of one of his handlers. I was in line minding my own business, and all I hear is this loud scream, this blood-curdling scream.
What the heck happened?
And I look, and she, because he had like a woman and a guy at his table, you know, helping him with money and stuff, and she's sitting at the table with her face in her hands.
Oh boy.
I'm sure out of sheer embarrassment, the guy handler is laughing his butt off, and Ferrigno's got this huge smile on his face, and I could see in his hand he was holding a Pennywise mask.
Oh no. That thing freaks me out.
You better be careful.
It's like on the posters.
Oh.
Yeah.
He was very proud of himself, the fact that he was able to scare her.
Oh, jeez.
So I missed him actually wearing it, but I could see him holding it, and I could figure out what had happened.
I imagine someone has a video or picture somewhere.
Oh, I'm sure.
Maybe, I don't know.
Better be careful.
Like, is he on Instagram or Twitter or something?
I have no idea.
I don't know.
Let me look.
So that was entertaining. Stuff like that keeps them waiting in line for not being that boring. But eventually got to the point where it was like my photo op with Christopher Eccleston was coming up. And I could see Chris was still at his table. So I was like, as long as Chris was at his table, I knew I was fine. I did not have to leave for the photo op area yet. And I got so far.
He does have an Instagram page, but sadly, no picture snap of the. Pennywise mask.
No, he's too busy scaring someone to think about. So I got so far into the line, and eventually Chris left, and I'm like, well, that's my sign, so I gotta go. So I abandoned ship again. And went and got in line for the photo op, I don't know how much of this is GalaxyCon and how much of this is the company that does the photo ops. I think it's probably more the company that does the photo ops, because, you know, the professional photography company that does these things. But I really like their setup, the way they were doing this. They had, celebrity photo ops. You've been to the convention, you've seen how this works with the professional photo ops. They just have a section that's curtained off, and they've got, you know, photography setups, usually multiple, so, you know, they can do multiple at the same time with different celebrities. But what they had is they took the area and set up lines. They put tape down with lines with numbers, nice big numbers at each line, so you could see which number was which. And then they could have signs they could put up at the front. And then they had this big digital sign. And I wish I'd gotten a picture of it. But it was this big digital sign that they could update if they needed to. But it had the celebrity name or whatever the photo op is, you know, whether it was a single celebrity, in some cases multiples. The photo op, what time it was supposed to be, whether the line was open yet for you to get into it. And then the line number, depending on whether, if you're a VIP, get in line 3. If you're general admission, get in line 4.
It sounds like arrivals and departures at airport.
Yeah, it is. It's like that meets like Disney World. So I was like, I was able to go and see the sign, but like Christopher Eccleston, 315, VIPs, line number, whatever, general admission, line, whatever, and I was just able to get in the line and not have to worry about whether I was in the right space or not. It was so nice! And they'd have somebody making announcements, you know, as photo op windows were closing, like, this is your last call for, you know, photo op with the 2 Power Rangers, if you've got, you know. So that was really cool. And like, if you would go and, you know, you show your proof of purchase for the photo op, and they give you tickets to give when you get to the actual like photo taking area, and they had plastic bins so you could put your stuff in. They could just you just put your stuff in the bin, and they'd move it down the table so that by the time you came out the other end, your stuff is right there. So that was really cool. It was, you know, the photo ops are really, really quick for most conventions just because of the sheer number of people they got to get through. So it's really like, you know, come up, smile, snap, move on. Chris was you know, really nice about it. I was in my Time Buster cosplay. So I got I took the wand off and had that in my hand, and then I had the Duff door too. And he's like, oh, you got a lot going on here. I was like, yeah, just a bit. So, but you know, took the photo. He was really nice. Shook my hand after the photo. So, got my picture, and all their pictures include a high resolution digital download as well. So you can go to the website and download the. So you've got a digital copy of it too, and they put the number automatically prints on like a real small print on the edge of the photo, so you can go and find it. You can look it up really easy on their website. So that's really cool. So then I got in line for Bautista again.
Take three, third
time's a charm, and in this case it was the charm. So once again, waited. Line would slowly move. This time the VIP line was very short with hardly anybody in it, so it was really just us general admission people taking up the floor space. Again, chatted with people while waiting, talking about, you know, who else we'd seen or if they'd been to this convention before, that sort of thing. At one point, Brett Spiner walked by and he looked at and he kind of turned to me and the two people in front of me, this lady, I think her son, that I was chatting with. He's like, "What's a Bautista?"
Oh boy.
He was a wrestler, but now he's an actor. And he's like, "Well, I know something about wrestling, but what's he in now?" And I was like, "Well, Guardians of the Galaxy." He's like, "Oh, I don't know anything about that." He's like, "I think I'm supposed to wrestle him later." Yeah, sure, let me put that on my schedule. Drax versus Data, let's see how that goes.
Oh boy.
this is funny. Brett Spiner is like, "What's a Bautista?"
Oh my.
You need to put that on a t-shirt.
I mean, that sounds like a thing Drax would say.
Yeah, I know.
Right. That needs to be on one of the Marvel DVD extras.
Yeah.
An interview between Drax and Dave Bautista. Yeah. That could be one of the lines.
But eventually it was my turn, so I got up there and was able to get my autograph, and because I was so far up earlier that morning when waiting for Chris, and because Bautista's table was literally right next to it, I could see as they were setting things up, and you know, they're setting out like Sharpies and you know Kleenex and bottles of water and that sort of thing. But then on Bautista's table, they set out one of those jumbo bags of peanut M&Ms.
Ooh, yep.
I was like, "Oh, that's cool." So later that day, when it was after the third time in line and it got to my turn, I was able to get the autograph, and the M&Ms were still there, and he had a little plate and he had some on there, and I was like, "Oh, peanut M&Ms, huh?" He's like, "Yeah." I was like, "Yeah, I like those too." He's like, "Would you like some?" I'm like, "No, not really, unless you're offering." He's like, "Oh yeah, take a couple." I'm like,
okay. So you got to share peanut M&Ms with Dave Bautista.
Yes, I did. It was actually awesome. The second time that day that I got chocolate from someone from the MCU, actually, because I got an autograph. I went and got an autograph from Chris Sullivan, which, if you watch This Is Us, I think most people know him probably from that. But he also played Taserface in Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. And he had Hershey Kisses on his on his table. I was like, "You've got chocolate." He's like, "I'll take a couple." I'm like, "Sweet." So I got chocolate from Taserface and Drax of the Destroyer.
Nice.
Well, now you know if you do happen to meet them again, what to bring is
exactly
his little gift.
Yeah. I even sent a tweet to Bautista later when I got home. I'm like, "Thanks for the M&Ms." I doubt he saw it, but you know, yeah, trying to be polite.
Ah, yes. And if he did see the tweet, he's probably like, "Oh, she remembered."
Yeah. I do like peanut M&Ms. I like them better than traditional M&Ms, although I prefer peanut butter M&Ms. But
that's
peanut M&Ms will work. So,
yep.
Yeah, I actually had one of those giant bags of peanut butter M&Ms recently. So,
if I had my choice, it's peanut butter. But if I can't, and it's between plain and peanut, I'm going peanut.
Yep.
They tried to rebrand the plain as milk chocolate, and I'm like, nah, they're still plain.
Yeah,
plain. Yep.
So other than that, I did stop by at one point. Barry Bostwick was there, and I did stop by his table. He's once again selling underwear. And I showed him a picture. I got a picture of the underwear I bought from him at PopCon Fort Wayne, and showed him where it is now hanging up in my house.
Oh my!
Because like the gal was like, she's like, were you coming to buy Barry's underwear? I'm like, actually, I already did. I came to show him where I have it displayed in my
honor.
Yes. So I showed him. I put him in a shadow box. So they're in a frame with a very glittery red sparkly background, very Frankenfurter-esque, with some like movie paraphernalia type stickers, like a movie reel and a director's chair and stuff. So it's in a nice display right next to our picture of Chauncey and I with Stan Lee. So.
Wow, that is classy.
Yeah.
In good company.
Yeah. He's like, oh, that's great. He's like, yeah, that's pretty awesome. He's like, now go show that to other people and tell them to come buy my underwear. He's still got kids in college.
On it, Mr. Mayor.
Yeah.
I will go be a walking advertisement for you.
So after I got Bautista's autograph, I called it quits and actually ended up going home. I would have liked to have stayed for like the cosplay contest, but that was still like 3 hours away. Ooh. And at that point, other than the break in my car at lunchtime and a couple of bathroom breaks, I had been standing essentially on concrete all day. And my lower back was not having it. As comfortable as my Time Busters cosplay is, you stand on concrete for so long, and it does not matter what you're wearing. It hurts. So I was like, I was tired, and I was hungry again, and my back hurt. And I was like, if I stay, I'm going to have to find a way to kill time before the cosplay contest. And
and you were only there for the day, and sounds like you packed in plenty.
Yeah,
everything like, you got. You
I didn't.
To do.
I didn't wander the vendor hall at all, except to get to and from the areas I needed to get to, which is good because I spent a lot of money on autographs and photos. I didn't go to any panels or anything. It was a quick trip. It was down. Autographs, pictures, go home. You know. So yeah, trying to keep the spending to a minimum.
Mm-hmm. Understandable.
But it's a nice con. I like the way that they did a good job, I think, of handling the crowds. Because there were some celebrities there that demanded some consistent crowds. Like I said, Bautista had a line pretty much all day. Felicia Day had a line pretty much the whole day. It's a nice con, and it's now on my radar, which is bad for my wallet. But
yeah, I was about to ask, would you go again? If
I would go again, it would have to be because there's somebody there that I want to see. I don't think that's one that I would go to just for the heck of it.
Mm-hmm.
But apparently in years past with this convention, they've had like Matt Smith. so How I've missed out on this before is beyond me, but now that I'm aware of it, I will keep my eyes peeled. So heaven forbid I need to spend more money on more Doctor Who and MCU autographs. So so that was my Saturday. So I got to spend Doctor Who's birthday. There's my segue. So I got to spend Doctor Who's birthday with the Ninth Doctor. And speaking of Doctor Who's birthday, that is our topic for this week, because it just so happens to have been Doctor Who's 56th birthday over the weekend.
On Saturday, which I realized when they did the 50th, the 23rd actually fell on Saturday that year as well. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah.
I was just, I don't know. It was one of those things I'm like, dang, I'm really glad the 50th anniversary fell on a Saturday that year.
Yeah.
I don't know.
That would have made things really inconvenient.
Yeah. But, I don't know. I was waxing nostalgic about, because that was a fun, that was such year.
It's always fun when it pops up on my, like, time hop and my Facebook memories, because I the countdown, like, I'm counting down to both the day, you know, the anniversary day plus Chicago TARDIS, because I went to Chicago TARDIS that year. Mm-hmm. So I'm like counting down to both, and then seeing the posts from, like, going to see Day of the Doctor, and then the posts way later that day, or maybe even the following day, of talking about our 4-hour hangouts.
Yep.
Post Day at the Doctor. So that was the early
we didn't record it, but
the podcast.
Yeah, didn't record it, but that could be the official unofficial first episode of this podcast.
Yeah. That's where the germ started. There's obviously 56, not necessarily a reason for a big anniversary special, but as we are barreling towards the 60th, which is crazy to think about,
right?
We thought it would be fun to take a look at the history of Doctor Who anniversary specials. Now, obviously, there are other specials, like Christmas specials. There's the year specials when David Tennant's run, including an Easter special. But we're talking specifically Doctor Who anniversary specials. So the holiday specials can be their own episode at some point, I guess. And we actually have got a lot to talk about here.
It's like,
which people may not realize just how much anniversary content there actually is.
I know, because
although some of it's a bit convoluted.
I mean, because you think, like, okay, you know, yeah, the 50th, that only comes around, I mean, you're only going to have one 50th anniversary, but, you know, every so often they get, you know, especially the every 10 years sort of thing, although the wilderness years kind of got a little muddled because wilderness years. But, you know, looking through all the ways that, you know, whether it's on TV or Big Finish or something else, it always seems like someone is marking Doctor Who Day on those important milestone years. And it's like, that's very cool. Even like the 45th anniversary kind of got one from Big Finish.
Yeah.
And if you squint and tilt your head a little bit.
Yeah. Yeah. So I have in the show notes a Gizmodo article that I was using to reference that was written before the 50th anniversary, but it's supposed to be the complete guide to every single Doctor Who anniversary, you know, entry into the mythos that is Doctor Who. And it explains why some of it's a little convoluted, but we will get to that. So the first anniversary that was celebrated was the 10th anniversary with the three Doctors. which is a story with Troughton and Pertwee and Hartnell to a point.
Yeah.
You've achieved a transference of.
Splendid.
But I don't think it's going to work.
Why, what's wrong?
They refuse to cooperate.
I see. Well, we'll soon settle that. Show me the earliest, Doctor.
But him too, sir, but surely...
Show me. He'll keep them in order.
Well, you've been fiddling with it, haven't you?
It was perfectly all right until you touched it. Now, if only you'd leave things to me.
If we were to leave things to you, my dear fellow, we'd be in a fine pickle, wouldn't we?
Well, look, there you go again. You lost the image, not
I
me.
I did not lose the image.
I said this
you
thing.
Saw it.
Look,
it
both
not
of you.
Its own accord.
Look.
Ah, there you are. I seem to be stuck up here. Oh, so you're my replacements. A dandy and a clown. Have you done anything?
Well, we've assessed the situation.
Just as I thought. Nothing.
Well, it's not easy, you know.
Not as if we knew what that stuff is.
No.
Then I'll tell you. It's a time bridge.
Is it what? I see.
Now, what's a bridge for, eh?
Well, crossing.
Right. So stop dilly-dallying and cross it.
No, wait!
You faded him again.
I did not
yes,
fade.
You
saw
him.
I hate to ask, but who was that?
Me!
So...
I was watching the Three Doctors whatever day it was, and after Jared was working late, and he came home, and I was, like, on the last episode, and he's like, now why, like, it's the Three Doctors, why are there only two, and why is the first Doctor only in the screen? And, you know, so yeah. I had to explain to him, well, William Hartnell was old, his health wasn't doing so well, so he was in a limited role.
Yeah.
They were lucky they got as much as they did.
Yeah. Well, and what's funny is this is celebrated as the 10th anniversary special. This didn't air in the 10th. It didn't start airing in the 10th anniversary year, because it would have been 1973. This actually started airing in December, late December of 1972. So it's a four-parter. So it went from 30th of December 72 to the 20th of January 1973. So it helped lead into the 10th anniversary year. But unlike other or later anniversary specials, did not air in like November of whatever year would have been appropriate math wise. But yes, at this point, William Hartnell was older. His memory was not very good, so he was not able to remember lines, which he was not very good at remembering lines anyway when he was the Doctor. But at this point, he got really bad, because, like, when they contacted him, he was totally down for it. He was like, yeah, absolutely. You know, sign me up. I will be there with, you know, my Doctor outfit on. I'm totally in, like, Flynn. And his wife actually had to go to the powers that be and be like, yeah, no, Bill can't do this.
She said, like, you caught him on one of his better days.
Yeah.
And so at least, so, you know, they got him as much as they did.
Yeah. So he did come in. The stuff that you see, other than the shot of of him in the garden, which actually was shot at his house. All the other stuff was filmed at the BBC's Ealing Studios, but they did do promotional photos at his home along with the shot of him in the garden. Because there's a bit of an urban legend that it was, like, all shot at his house.
Yeah, I remember hearing something, like, it was all shot, like, in his garage or something.
No, that's just an urban legend.
Mm-hmm. Which, I mean, I'm going to skip ahead a little bit. If you've watched Adventure in Space and Time, and, you know, obviously it's a fictionalized account of, you know, the origins of Doctor Who, but one thing they did, it seems to be pretty well known is just how much Hartnell loved the show, how much he didn't want to quit, and it's just his health kind of forced him to in the end. And so just the fact that he was able to participate in that small amount in this anniversary special, I think it probably meant a lot to him, even though, you know, he was just not able to do as much as I'm sure he probably wanted to. So I even as I was watching it, and you can kind of tell that when he's doing his lines that he's like, you know, maybe reading them off a cue card or something.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah, it just also seems like you just, it's like the twinkle's still there. Like, yeah. I love watching the first Doctor. I know he kind of gets derided as, oh, he was the old grumpy and he was hard to work with and blah, blah, blah. But I don't know. There's just kind of a sparkle in him and in his stories. And, you know, people who haven't watched any first Doctor, I just would encourage you to go back and look out for some of those gems. Cause he was, you know, he's Susan's grandfather, but he's kind of a grandfather to all his companions, even the ones that maybe they didn't get along off screen so well. Mm-hmm. But, you know, life happens, and it's unfortunate that it did. But, you know, he seemed to be a sweetheart.
Yeah. I don't think this was intentional, but with this anniversary special, they kind of set a precedent for pretty much every subsequent anniversary special so far to, one, be a multi-doctor story for the most part, mm-hmm. and two, involve expanding on the lore and history that we know of the Time Lords and Gallifrey for sure. And the Doctor's history, because this story involves Omega, which is one of the founders of Time Lord Society and was actually the one that figured out how to do time travel. So even though it does take place in a rock quarry for a good chunk of it, which if you read the novelization, apparently it rationalizes why they're seemingly in a rock quarry. The rationale in the novelization is that at that point, Omega had, as it's explained somewhat in the story, Omega is that where he's living exists out of his sheer will. And when he first created it, it was more lush of a landscape. But since he's grown weary over time using the mental effort, it's now been like all the greenery and everything that would have been there has gone, and now it's just dirt and rocks. And that's why they were able to use a rock quarry. So.
Nice. You know, it's fitting that they did. I mean, yeah. where would Doctor Who be without the BBC rock quarry?
Yes.
Right? Yeah. And their numerous corridors.
Yeah.
Yep.
And of course we get, because this is during the run of the third Doctor, so it's, you know, at this point, he's still earthbound. But so he's working with UNIT. So we get the Brigadier, and the Brigadier being, this is actually the Brigadier seeing the inside of the TARDIS for the first time in this episode.
Yeah, there are actually a lot of milestones in this one.
Yeah.
When you think about it.
Yeah. It's just fun. The banter between Troughton and Pertwee is hilarious, and apparently they enjoyed it so much that they continued it beyond their times. Like when they meet up at conventions, they were always like, you know, making fun of each other.
Oh man,
in a nice way, but
yeah, that would have been something to see,
right?
So, but yeah, rock quarries and a lot of bubble wrap, seemingly, because it seems like Omega's like, once you get inside his like the castle or whatever, it seems to be like covered in bubble wrap. This one painted red.
At least they painted it red and, you know, made an effort. It's not just bubble wrap.
Yeah. There's some good lines in this one. At some point, because the Brigadier is having trouble wrapping his mind around regeneration, even at this point, even though the Third Doctor is the second Doctor he's met. But at one point, he's like, as long as he gets the job done, he can wear whatever face he likes.
Oh, and I love the bit where, you know, the Third Doctor and Joe have been, you know, spirited off to the antimatter universe, and the second Doctor's there trying to fix things, and the Brigadier comes in, and he's like, well, you're gonna come and talk to Geneva and explain things to him. And I was like, you're gonna have the second Doctor show up and try to explain this. Oh my gosh. I mean, that doesn't actually happen because, you know, the rest of the story takes precedent, but I'm just like, oh, Brigadier, I adore you, and he's just all about rules and procedure, and it's always been a good contrast between him and whatever Doctor incarnation.
And I could see if that did happen. I could just see Patrick Shouten playing the recorder to
Geneva.
Yeah,
or just saying, where's my recorder? Have you seen it?
Yeah. Exactly.
Because he was looking for it the whole time.
He thinks Jamie might have hidden it.
Yeah.
Possibly. Yep. I mean, Jamie in his day was a professional piper.
True.
He's like, stop with that. He's probably offended his Scots sensibilities.
Yes.
If there's going to be any instrument playing, it's going to be on the bagpipes.
Yep. Yes. Oh my. So 5 years later, 1978 was the 15th anniversary of Doctor Who, but there was not a special because at the time they were smack dab in the middle of the Key to Time arc. On the 25th of November of 78, Androids of Tara actually aired. So instead, a long-running program on the BBC called Nationwide ran a tribute, and Tom Baker appeared on hand in costume. I've not been able to find that to watch it. The one link that's in the article, if you click on it, it says it's not available in the country, at least in America. So it's been quashed by the BBC.
Rats.
So, yeah, if anybody can find a link to it on someplace else so that we could see it, that would be awesome.
Send it to us in feedback.
Yeah, because you can find a lot of stuff on YouTube, but every now and then you'll click on it and be like, no, this is not allowed to be played in your country.
Mm-hmm. Or if you can find it on like Vimeo or one of those other lesser known video hosting things.
Yeah. And if anyone's curious, if you want to go backwards for what would be the show's fifth anniversary, which was 68, there actually was an episode that aired on November 23rd, 1968. It was the fourth episode of The Invasion. But unfortunately, that episode no longer exists. In its original form, there is an animated reconstruction on the DVD.
If I remember right, although I'd have to go back and look at my DVD, that one might be the one where the Cybermen finally show up at the end.
Yes.
Yes.
Yep. Would be correct. So, moving ahead to the 23rd of November, 1983. So at this point, I was like 9 months old. So, no idea that this was a thing. We have the 20th anniversary special, The Five Doctors, which is what it's called, but technically it's The Five-ish Doctors, because now we have, at this point, this is during Peter Davison's run. So we've had five incarnations of the Doctor, but Tom Baker bowed out and declined to appear.
So they end up using some unused footage from Shada. Although everybody's seen that footage from Shada now because of all the versions of Shada we have.
So canonically, we're just going to pretend that the Fourth Doctor got plucked out in the middle of his adventure with Shada
and got stuck.
He was stuck, and then he got sent back, and Shada continued as it went. So, you know.
Yes, which is how they hand waved it away. Kind of like what they did with the three Doctors, why Hartnell never appeared in the same room with the other two, is that they were trying to pluck the first and second Doctors out of his time stream to help the third Doctor, but the first Doctor got stuck in a time eddy. So they've always been able to hand wave it away when a Doctor is not like able to physically appear. In this case, they did some jiggery pokery with unused footage for Tom Baker's Doctor. And at this point, William Hartnell had been gone for almost a decade, actually. He passed in 75. Richard Herndahl was brought in to act in the First Doctor's place, which I will be honest, back when I first got into Doctor Who and was binging anything and everything I could get my hands on, and therefore was not necessarily retaining things just because I was watching so much in such a short time frame, I did not realize it was a different actor playing the first Doctor. I mean, hindsight now, it's very obvious. I mean, Herndahl, he looks like, if he had been the first Doctor from the very beginning, it totally would have worked. But it did not occur to me that this is not the same actor that I had seen previously. But in my defense, I am bad with faces. So, it still am.
Ah, there you are at last, my dear fellow. What kept you?
What kept me? Of all the confounded arrogance.
Never mind. You can tell me later. Come and take a look at this.
What is it?
Tegan. Sarah.
Fascinating.
What's happened to the little fellow?
The little fellow is perfectly all right, thank you very much. Of course I'm here. You don't imagine anything you two can do would stump me, do you? Let's have a look. What's this?
Brigadier.
Good heavens. It's Miss Smith, isn't it? Miss Travanka. Don't ask me how we got here. It was like a cross between Guy Fawkes and Halloween.
Lethbridge Stewart? Oh, my dear fella. How very nice to see you again.
Great heavens, you as well. Well, I can't exactly say it's nice to be here. Do you know I was enjoying...
You must excuse me, old chap. We have a very important inscription to translate, and I think they'll get it all wrong without me.
Typical. Absolutely typical.
Oh, I know. Drag you through time and space without so much as a by your leave, then leave you out when things get interesting.
My version isn't any better.
Well, which one's yours?
So that's what it's all about. I never dreamed.
It changes nothing. Absolutely nothing. We lure the force field, get the young fellow back from Gallifrey, and all go home. This doesn't concern us. It mustn't.
What does the inscription say?
Yes, I'd quite like to know as well.
Yes, we've all been through a great deal to get here.
You? Tell them. It's Old High Gallifrey, the ancient language of the Time Lords. Not many people understand it these days. Fortunately, I do.
It's all very interesting, I'm sure, doctors, but what does it say?
That this is the tomb of Rassilon, where Rassilon lies in eternal sleep.
It also says that anyone who's got this far has passed a number of dangers and shown great courage and determination. What does this bit mean?
To lose is to win, and he who wins shall lose.
I know what it says. What does it mean? It also promises that whoever takes the ring from Rassilon's hand and puts it on shall get the reward he seeks.
What reward?
Immortality.
What, live forever, never die?
That is what the word means, young man.
But that's impossible.
Apparently not.
It seems Rassilon possesses it now and is willing to share it with whoever takes the ring.
Thank you, gentlemen. That is exactly what I needed to know. I came here to help you. A little unwillingly, but I came. My services were scorned, my help refused. Now I shall help myself to immortality.
Out of the question!
You're hardly a suitable candidate.
For anything.
The decision is scarcely yours. Killing you once was never enough for me, Doctor. How gratifying to do it three times over.
Nice to see you again.
Oh, one thing that always cracks me up is like when people are like telling new fans, like, where do you like, okay, I've watched all of New Who and I want to try some classic. What are some good episodes to go with, or, you know, how to do it. And almost universally people say, do not watch the Five Doctors first thing. Can you take a wild guess what my very first classic Who episode was?
Gee, I wonder.
And honestly, I kind of credit that with that making the Fifth Doctor my doctor. I don't really know why, but I guess because he actually got more to do in this story, and I was like, hey, I kind of like him. I was curious who Tegan and Turlough were and all those kinds of things, and I'm just like, hey, I mean, it makes sense because, you know, this special takes place in the middle of his run, so it, you know, give the star who is the star now more to do, or, you know, more parts of the story, especially at the end. So, but I'm just like, yeah, Fivey, he's my guy. and a large part is because I watched the Five Doctors, first of all. I did what all the veteran fans tell you not to do. And guess what? I had fun. I thought it was a good way to sample a whole bunch of them at the same time.
Oh, yeah. Well, and there's a lot crammed into this story. So, because once again, we've got the Doctor having to be plucked out of his time stream. In this case, unlike the Three Doctors where the Time Lords are plucking him out of the time stream, it's someone else plucking him out of the time stream. Oh. And everyone being, well, there's a twist in there. But the Doctor's incarnations and some of his companions and some of his adversaries being sent to the Death Zone on Gallifrey, home of the Tomb of Rassilon.
This is where you get the scrolls of Rassilon, the ring of Rassilon, the frilly knickers of Rassilon.
always poke fun at that. It's like Rassilon's like a hoarder or something.
He's like yogurt. Rassilon is on the side gig here.
God,
it's like
willing,
the black scrolls we'll all be, of Rassilon.
We'll all be
reunited. Of Rassilon. The ring of Rassilon.
We'll all be reunited in the sequel. The sequel of Rassilon, The Search for More Money.
Exactly. So even as much as what's crammed in here, there's even more that they wanted to cram and couldn't. Because they wanted like the Autons to appear. Louise Jameson asked to come back to play Leela and they couldn't fit her in. They wanted Katie Manning to come back as Jo Grant, but they would have been too expensive because she was living in Australia at the time.
Okay. I got a timeout. They could have fit Leela in because the Doctor left her on Gallifrey.
Yeah.
She could have been there. Oh my gosh.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah. They wanted Deborah Watling to come back to play Victoria. And couldn't figure out how to get her in. Mary Tam, who played Romana One, wasn't asked. Which would have been a little weird. It's already weird with the Shada thing because we get Romana 2 in that clip.
Yeah, that's true.
So to have both Romanas would have been, I think, a bit weird.
Well, that would have been a little hard to explain.
Yeah.
Well, they have all the Doctors. I guess you could just say, well, we got all the Romanas.
Okay. Yeah.
Or one Romana. And one stuck in a time, Eddie.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But we do have a Dalek. We have Cybermen. We have the master, Ithanaeli's master.
Looking silver ninja type robots.
The Rastan warrior robots.
Which was added at the last minute, actually. It was supposed to be a scene with the quarks. And then they changed it to this new adversary, the Rastan warrior.
Which they've never used since.
Yeah.
Which I think, if memory serves, I think it was that was an invention of John Nathan Turner, the producer, and I think he actually directed that bit, because they were stretched for time, I guess, and he had to step in and do that, and apparently he had a little too much fun with it.
Yeah.
Because it was like, because he had a little too much fun with the Rastan warrior skewering Cybermen.
That's one of the things. That's one of my comments I wrote down when watching it. Cybermen die funny in this one.
Yeah. I think it was due to a not a fight, but like a minor scuffle between Turner and the. I want to say it was Terrence Dix, because Terrence Dix liked the Cybermen, or one of them liked the Cybermen, the other didn't, and I don't know, something.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. I think it's on the DVD extra stuff, so.
Yeah. So,
go watch those interviews. They're fun if you've got the DVD.
Yeah. Once again, we get some more history of Gallifrey, the Time Lords, in this case with Rassilon instead of Omega. But we get to learn some more about the Doctor's history, because the Master ends up encountering every incarnation of the Doctor that's in there, and mentions at one point to the first Doctor that they went to the Academy together. So we get that nice little tidbit there. And of course, there are callbacks to the previous anniversary special with the second Doctor saying, "I don't like it," when talking about unit headquarters in this case.
You redecorated.
Yeah. I don't like it.
And thus that line gets used in nearly every anniversary special subsequent to this.
Yeah.
Which it's a cheeky little aside.
Yeah. We get a reverse the polarity of the neutron flow.
Basically, this story is just, here, these are all my Doctor Who toys. Throw them in the sandbox and see what they do.
Mm-hmm.
And it's fun. I mean, it's an anniversary special. It's supposed to be a little bonkers.
Yeah.
Well, and like you were saying, Christy, it kind of gave you a good taste, too, for the other Doctors. Because, I mean, I knew about Baker. I knew a little bit about Davidson before, but I didn't know about Pertwee. And then seeing him in that, it's like, ooh, I kind of like you. Let me... they can find some more episodes, and there we go.
Yep. I mean, in our notes here, I was talking about like the pairings of the Doctors and the Companions, and how if Tom Baker had come on, it would have been him and Sarah Jane Smith, and it'd been Pertwee and the Brigadier. And you can kind of that's one thing that I kind of watch it and I regret a little bit. So I'm like, oh, I would have loved to have seen Sarah Jane with the fourth Doctor. Would have loved to have seen the Brigadier with the third. A little, I mean, he gets a scene or two with him, but a little bit more.
Mm-hmm.
Or if they could get, I mean, they couldn't get Fraser Hines to come on more than what they got because he was on a different show. So, but you know, I mean, what they got was still really good. It's just there's just kind of that feeling of what could have been, but it was still, I mean, watching Sarah Jane and the third Doctor, it's good, it's fun. And two and Brigadier. Well,
considering that was kind of the original pairing after Joel left, it was third Doctor and Sarah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yep. So.
No, it was still, it's still fun. And you know, you get all the Time Lord lore in there, and and adding
on. The doctor
on it,
becomes Lord President of Galaxy.
Lord President, which makes a couple of years later when they do Trial of a Time Lord a little awkward.
Yeah.
Not in the shows, not from a watching the show standpoint, but from the Time Lords, like, oh yeah, you're our president, but we don't care anymore because we want to beat you up.
Well, considering that he didn't really want the position in the first place.
Yeah. True.
How many times have they tried to kill him and it not be the master?
Yeah. So jumping ahead 5 more years to the 25th anniversary, and this is where it gets kind of convoluted, because there are two camps. There are the people that recognize the Silver Nemesis as the official 25th anniversary special, because the first episode of it aired on the 23rd of November. But there's a lot of people that think that the Silver Nemesis is crap, and therefore consider the storyline that aired before it, Remembrance of the Daleks, a better anniversary story. Even though it actually aired before the anniversary.
I will say Silver Nemesis is fine. Remembrance of the Daleks is better, but I wouldn't say Silver Nemesis is crap. If only because you have Lady Poof Pants.
Yeah.
she cracks me up all the time every time I watch that.
Well, as far as like John Nathan Turner and all was concerned, the people in charge consider this the actual anniversary special, and it's called the Silver Nemesis because 25 years is a silver anniversary.
Yeah. Right.
And Cybermen are silver.
Yeah.
So,
which led to a lot of jokes that the 50th anniversary was going to be called Golden Nemesis and it would be all about Daleks, which they weren't wrong.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah. So we could talk about both real quickly here. Yeah, just because, yes, Remembrance of the Daleks is a better story of the two, if for anything else, which gone down in history because it's the one where Ace beats up a Dalek with a baseball bat. So
I was listening to
Sophie Aldred has said that that's one of the greatest moments in her entire life, behind getting married and having kids.
Yeah. There was, I was listening to Light at the End, which is the Big Finish 50th anniversary, and they have a whole bunch. I have the limited edition download, which has all the behind the scenes interviews and stuff. Yeah. And Sophie Aldred was talking about, I want it on my tombstone, she beat up a Dalek with a baseball bat.
Mm-hmm. speaking of Sophie Aldred with the baseball bat, there was a meme going around with Negan from Walking Dead, I make baseball bats look good. And then there's a picture of Sophie Aldred with a baseball bat, and it's like, please.
Yeah.
I was like, yeah, ace you in this one.
Yeah.
I don't care if you've got spikes on yours, Megan. Ace took out two Daleks.
Yeah.
Have that.
So we've got, it's an interesting Dalek story, because we have like the Daleks that we know, but then like there's a second group of Daleks that apparently has rebelled from Dalek society and started their own faction.
Like,
really? They
did,
like, they're you're Daleks. He's like, what do you have to rebel against? You're Daleks. But it's an interesting thing, especially because, again, it's a lot of people like to consider this the 25th anniversary special because of when and where it takes place, and it's kind of a pseudo sequel to An Unearthly Child, because we go back to Trotter's Lane. It's 1963. It's November 22nd, 1963. As far as this in the story is concerned. So that's why a lot of people like to consider this kind of a pseudo anniversary special too, even though it was not labeled that way. And we get some more some more time lord and doctor lore with the Hand of Omega and which isn't actually a hand, they just call it that, but it's actually just a tool that Omega, it was the device that he created to manipulate the stars so that they could develop time travel. So there's some interesting facts with this particular one. It's the first UK drama serial to be recorded and broadcast in stereo.
Cool.
This is the first instance of the skeleton effect that we now know and see all the time whenever someone's shot with a Dalek weapon. At Coal Hill School, which is, again, back to an unearthly child, the sign says the headmaster's name is H. Parson. Hugh Parson was the videotape editor for Doctor Who. So, let's see here. William Thomas, who played Martin in the story, went on. Has the designation of being an actor that's appeared in Classic Who, New Who, and Torchwood, because he played Mr. Cleaver in Boomtown, and then played Garant in Miracle Day.
Oh,
I don't remember that character, but so let's see here. The Dalek ship landing was a practical effect done with a model ship and landing it with a crane, which is why it looks as good as it does. Once we get to the Silver Nemesis, the special effects kind of go out the window. In the fourth episode of the story, when the special weapons Dalek blows up the gate to the junkyard. The pyrotechnics were so strong that they blew out windows in nearby buildings.
I remember hearing that trending in the commentary.
Yeah.
Whoop.
Oopsies.
Yeah, someone they called the fire brigade and they came and the Daleks started coming out of the smoke and they're like, what?
Yep. Sophie Aldred was actually taught to fire guns so that when she shoots the Dalek, she could actually do it properly. So the role of Mike was originally offered to Mark McGann, Paul McGann's brother.
Oh wow.
Wow, that would have been a connection. What could have been indeed.
So then the actual, I guess, proper anniversary special, Silver Nemesis, which, once again, not a multi-doctor story. This is one of the few exceptions where it's not a multi-doctor story. With the Cybermen instead of Daleks. So... But this one involves a time-traveling witch and her lackey, who apparently really regrets his life choices. It seems like they travel to the future and he's like on his hand, you know, like realizes what's happening. He's like on his knees on the ground. Like, I promise to give to the poor. And just get me out of this. It's an okay story. We do get there are some interesting things that occur in this, because in modern day, quote unquote modern day, a lot of it takes place around Windsor Castle. And they wanted some of the royal family, including the queen, to make an appearance, but the royal family refused. So they ended up using a double for the queen, although the corgis are real. There are corgis in Doctor Who. Mm-hmm.
That's canon.
Favorite part of this entire story.
Mm-hmm.
And
you
we
know,
do that's... see the Doctor with a fez. So if anyone
yes.
ever asks where a fez is, has appeared in Classic Who, there you go.
That's right. I forgot about that until now.
Yeah. I was like, oh, a fez, and then later in that same story, I'm like, oh, corgis!
And it's not the only time the quote-unquote queen has shown up in Doctor Who later in Voyage of the Damned. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. You would see a double from behind. You'd see the queen, and she is thanking the Doctor as the starship Titanic is thoroughly Mrs. Buckingham Palace.
Yeah.
That's yeah, there's actually no sense to anyone who doesn't watch Doctor Who.
Yeah.
Exactly.
There are a couple of times where they tried to get the Queen into Doctor Who, and at one point, I don't remember what story it was, but they wanted her, but the Queen... I guess they said that the queen would not, because she would have been playing a fictional version of herself instead of it like being a cameo, and they did not want the queen not playing herself. So they declined. So the only time that she's technically appeared is it the... Is it this Remembrance of the Guy? Whichever one where it starts with... Again, my story's all mixed up now. I've watched so much stuff very recently. Where it starts with a bunch of like different speeches, audio clips playing at the very beginning, and one of them is the Queen, and that's an actual like legit audio clip. So from a speech. I can't remember which one it is now. I'm starting to pull them together. I just remember that one's corgis. It's corgis in Doctor. I yelled at Johnsy. I'm
focus,
like, corgis.
Focus on what's important, Rachel.
Exactly.
The corgis.
Well, I mean, seriously, you got people on a tour of Windsor Castle, and they put a sign out that says, "Do not enter royal apartments." You know, if you didn't label it, people are less likely to be compelled to go through the door.
Yeah, exactly.
True.
Dag
it's
Nabbit,
human nature.
Because Dag Nabbit, I probably would have not for the queen, but because I know she's got corgis.
Yep.
Yeah.
So if Rachel ever goes on vacation to London and is at Windsor Castle, I don't know. It's
been
I don't
very
know.
Good.
Windsor Castle is in London. Yes.
And, whichever castle the
hear,
queen happens to be at the moment.
Wherever she is. And then you hear a news story like, the queen, well, some of the queen's corgis have gone missing. Check Rachel's...
I know nothing.
Rachel's carry-on.
Like, ma'am, your suitcase is panting now. No, pants. Not panting, pants.
It does that.
Yeah. Speaking of Windsor Castle, the group of tourists that we see enter when the Doctor and Ace sneak in, there's a whole bunch of that group is made up of previous like crew members, but it also includes Nicholas Courtney and Anthony Ainley.
Nice.
Now I need to go back and rewatch that one because
you can't tell. That's the thing. So at least when I watched it, you cannot tell. So because they definitely made sure you could only see those people from like behind.
So.
Well, that now we need CSI level photo enhancement.
Yeah, really. We need some HD up in here, which unfortunately we won't have that one's not on Blu-ray because that's the season before the Blu-ray that just got released or is getting ready be released. So you have to wait.
Maybe it'll get there. And it seems like they're making the rounds with those.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, the 30th anniversary, at this point, Doctor Who is off the air. It would be canceled the following year in 89.
At this point in 1993, it's sort of the redheaded stepchild of the BBC.
Yes. There is a idea that was written by a fan that actually approached the BBC with the plan to make a direct-to-video film to mark the 30th anniversary, but it never came to fruition officially. You can find it, a fan-animated production of it on YouTube. I tried to watch it. It is tough. It is tough to watch.
Oh, boy.
It is not. It is definitely very amateurish as far as the sound and the animation. I mean, obviously, you know, if the BBC had gotten behind it, they would have had some money. But even then, in the early 90s, we're talking early 90s animation technology. I got so far and I was like, I'm sorry, I can't watch anymore.
It's one of those, you see the meme where it's like half a gold star, you tried.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's called The Dark Dimension. And the general plot is that the seventh Doctor was going to die. And then we go to this, I guess, alternate timeline where the fourth Doctor never regenerated and is now living as like a hermit. And Ace is a school teacher and like an environmental activist, which is the case now. But there's these people that are time traveling and they go back in time to this alternate timeline to try and fix it so that the seventh Doctor doesn't die. It was supposed to be darker and scarier and a bit more mature. I can see what they were trying to do, and if they'd had the resources, it could have been something good, but it did not happen. So we have what is on the YouTube video. So, although I think I want to say that there's a version that just got released. Like maybe they've upgraded it or reanimated it or something, but I may be misremembering that. So that's what we could have gotten, but instead we got Dimensions in Time.
Which, if you thought the five Doctors was here, let me dump out my Doctor Who toys and see what they do, this one was the whole Doctor Who toy store, and probably not in a good way.
And mixed in with a British soap to boot.
Oh, gosh.
I watched the 30th anniversary, I can't talk. When I watched it, I was confused for a lot of reasons. One, because I just got into Doctor Who. I've only seen like a handful of the classic. Some of the stuff I didn't understand. And then, like, they throw this whole... all these characters that have nothing to do with Doctor. I'm like, who is this? you guys.
Now, to be fair, it was done for children in
children
need.
Children in need.
Yeah. True. So, and sometimes
it was done for charity.
Yeah, and sometimes those sketches they do some funky things, and they kind of can get away with it because it's a charity thing.
Yeah.
And
it's no, like, it's no time crash.
No, it's not. But, you know, sometimes they'll have like different mashups with different shows, and it makes sense to UK viewers of the time, but then you know anyone else later is like, what the heck is this?
Yeah, but if you don't watch EastEnders, then a lot of the other characters aren't Doctor Who. It's like, I don't know who this person is.
Yeah, it is notable for it being the only time the Sixth Doctor and the Brigadier were on screen together.
Yes,
very briefly. True. Although Big Finish rectified that and put them in a whole story a couple times, I think, mm-hmm. later. But as far as on screen appearances,
and in books.
Yeah, that is true. I think people are like, we can't let that be the only time the Sixth Doctor and Brigadier meet.
Watch this, and then when you need to metaphorically rinse your eyes and ears and mouth out with soap, metaphorically, and you still want the Sixth Doctor and the Brigadier, go listen to the Spectre of Lightning more. and you'll feel much better.
That is a really good one. And not just because they meet, but that's a good story in general.
Yeah.
I listen to that one a lot.
Yeah. But it's this convoluted story with a Ronnie who I love, one of my favorite villains of all time in Doctor Who. It's, again, petition, bring back the Ronnie in New Who. I've planted my flag on that hill. So we get the Ronnie who has trying to trap all of the Doctor's incarnations into a time loop, but it's a 20-year time loop in this street market on the East End of London, hence the EastEnders crossover. So, but she's, because of the time loop and time folding in on itself, you get these random combinations of doctors and companions that normally would not be together. Occasionally you do get the right ones. Like you get the Third Doctor and Sarah Jane. But then you get like the Sixth Doctor and the Brigadier, or the Seventh Doctor and Leela. they bounce from, this 20-year period, and it's just weird. It's just really, really
although I just realized something because I listened to The Light at the End, and there's a scene with the Sixth Doctor and Perry in that audio, and they're like all these different, like they're seeing all these different iterations of the TARDIS with the Doctor and his companions in there, and the Sixth Doctor goes, that's a previous, I think he sees the Seventh Doctor and Ace, and they go, that's a future incarnation of me. And Perry goes, and that's a future incarnation of me, referring to Ace. And I'm like, oh my gosh, you guys aren't referring to dimensions in time, are you? Where the Doctor and the companions keep switching up. It is a funny line in the audio though, but I'm just like, oh my gosh, did you guys just do that?
It's weird. I enjoy it though, because it's not considered canon by any means by like really anybody, but as far as I'm concerned, it's like, it's got the Sixth Doctor meeting the Brigadier. That's I'm down. So
it's kind of the Star Wars holiday special of Doctor Who.
A little bit, except this is a lot shorter. It's only 12 minutes long.
Yes. And it's never going to be officially released anywhere, so it's going to look for it on YouTube or somewhere.
Yeah, that's the only place you can watch it, because it was made with the understanding that it would never be repeated or released anywhere.
This was before the internet became what it is now.
Yeah.
Those musical interludes. Oh, boy.
Yeah. Oh, geez. Yeah. Bless their hearts. They tried. Mm-hmm. People were trying to various degrees of success.
Yeah.
So the 35th anniversary, we got a book called The Infinity Doctors, which I have not read, and I'm not even sure if that's one that's still in print that you can still get it, actually. I should have checked.
Just a second.
I might have a PDF of it.
Yeah. But yeah, it's set on Gallifrey. So, again, we're continuing that through line of anniversary specials tying back to Gallifrey and the Doctor's history. I guess it's written in a way that it never fully pins down which Doctor is in the story. So, but apparently the story involves a peace summit between the Santarans and the Rutans. Omega is in it.
Mm-hmm.
So
it's an Eighth Doctor book. It is available in ebook format. Just a second, I want to check something because I know that was a book selection for our book club, but I can't remember if we read it or not.
Yeah.
I want to say we might have. I'll look and continue on.
Yep. Oh, and then the 40th anniversary, as far as visual consumption is concerned, we got Scream of the Shalka, which I've watched once and will never, ever, ever watch ever again because there is literally screaming in it and it is annoying as hell.
Yes, I remember I've only watched it once and it was for Traveling the Vortex Friday Night Who They Did. So I had my headphones on because it was late at night and mm-hmm, I regretted that so much. Like,
It's an animated, Flash animated, which that dates it because nobody supports Flash anymore. Flash is dead. But it was a Flash animated Ninth Doctor at the time, played by Richard E. Grant, who would later go on to play Dr. Simeon / The Great Intelligence in several Matt Smith stories. So it's like the cast is impressive.
Yes.
You've got the Doctor. We've got a robot version of the Master. We've got a new companion named Allison. So it's written by Paul Cornell, who went on to write, New Who. It's got the Doctor in UNIT, but it's not pleasant to listen to. So, but like I said, the cast is good. You got Richard E. Grant playing the Doctor. You've got Sophie Okonedo, who played Allison. She would go on to play Liz 10 in The Beast Below. We've got Derek Jacobi playing the Robot Master, who would go on to play the actual Master / Dr. Yana. A small character who doesn't even have a name, just a title, The Caretaker, played by this guy named David Tennant.
It is so funny. Around this time period we're talking about, with Big Finish and Screaming the Shalka, David Tennant just kind of randomly pops up in these little things. Like, it's like, Doctor Who isn't on, but he's getting started as an actor, and he's, Doctor Who's the reason he became an actor. And, like, all these little projects, he's like, oh, it's Doctor Who, I want to be part of that. Just, let me have just this one little part.
Mm-hmm.
So I think, there's...
He ends up at Big Finish.
Yeah, he ends up over at Big Finish at least once. I want to say twice, but now I can't remember.
At least once officially that we know of.
Yeah. He's in that, the World War II one. He...
Colditz,
Yes.
He plays Nazi guard or something. He's got a fairly big part in that one.
Mm-hmm.
And then I think he was in, the Dalek, one of the Dalek War Empire...
Yeah, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And I did check. We haven't read Infinity Doctors yet in the book club. I remember I had posted it in the polls, but I could always toss it back on as a selection for later on, now knowing that it's an anniversary book.
Yep. So, yeah, Scream of the Shalka, again, it's out there on the internet. You can watch it if you want to. Just be prepared to turn down your volume quite often.
So, there's a reason like the anytime, title is
like, just like, Scream. Anytime it's like the doctor and the robot master talking, it's fine. But the minute you get the Shalka involved and they're screaming, it's like, no.
Yeah, there's a reason it's titled Scream of the Shalka.
Yeah, that is literal.
Yeah, I was going to say, sometimes Doctor Who titles can be a little, but this one is very on the nose.
Yeah,
quite.
So. That being said, thankfully, at this point, Big Finish is a thing.
Yeah. Save us, so, Big Finish, Juan Kenobi. Yes. You're our only hope.
Yes. Yeah, so, yeah. Well, exactly. they save us and probably confuse people at the same time, especially if you've not listened to a lot of Big Finish and don't know people by voice. You want to listen to like some regular other Big Finish first.
Yeah.
I would not jump into this if you don't know people's voices, especially the ones whose voices have changed with age. Some they still sound pretty close, but there are some of the actors where their voices have definitely changed as they've gotten older.
Yeah.
But that being said, once you can recognize people by voice, go and listen to Zagreus. So. Yep.
Zagreus sits inside your head. Zagreus lives among the dead. Zagreus sees you in your bed and eats you when you're sleeping.
Zagreus, at the end of days, Zagreus lies all other ways. Zagreus comes when time's a maze. History's weeping.
Zagreus taking time apart. Zagreus fears the hero heart. Zagreus seeks the final part, the reward that he is reaping.
Zagreus sings when all is lost. Zagreus takes all those he's crossed. Zagreus wins and all it cost, the hero's hearts he's keeping.
Zagreus seeks the hero's ship. Zagreus needs the web to rip. Zagreus sups time at a drip. And life aside, he's sweeping.
Yeah. And also, just as a point of reference, there were 3 audio stories released prior to this one. One was, let's see, Fifth Doctor was the Master. Sixth Doctor was Davros. And No. Fifth Doctor was Omega. Sixth Doctor was Davros. Seventh Doctor was Master. And so it kind of is like they each get paired with an adversary, and then it's leads into Zagreus somehow. Mm-hmm. It's kind of, so it's all been kind of one big anniversary celebration throughout the year. Because, yeah, you know, Big Finish is like, well, we're the only ones really doing anything, so why the heck not?
Yeah.
This is the 50th story, right? If I remember right.
Yeah, it was their 50th. Yeah, 50th their Big 50th, Finish release. Yeah,
in the main range, anyway.
Yeah. And it's a packed cast with Peter Davison, Colin Baker, Sylvester McCoy, Paul McGann, with India Fisher as Charlie, Lala Ward as Romana, Louise Jameson, Nicholas Courtney, some archived audio from John Pertwee, Annika Wills, Elizabeth Sladen, Mark Strickson, Sarah Sutton, Nicola Bryant, Bonnie Langford, Sophie Aldred, like all John Leeson. It's like you've got all of these names. So what's funny is other than Charlie, K-9, really almost everybody else is fun. Because you've got the doctors playing not their doctor.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Which again, it's like you get all these actors who've been in Doctor Who, but but they don't play. But it's like, well, you know, that's great. Like, are you just gonna have them sit in a room and talk to each other as their characters? Well, no, we're gonna write a completely bonkers story, and they're going to play all these different people because reality is really messed up currently.
Yeah, and they are a little on the long side, but they are very, very enjoyable.
Mm-hmm. From what I mean, yeah,
it's been a while since I've listened to them. Yeah. But I kind of made sure I had them boom, 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 boom.
Yeah. I mean, it is quite, you know, it is a time commitment, but once you get into it. And then also I have to mention, you also have to start with Neverland, which is the previous Eighth Doctor. That one really sets up.
Because you need, it helps if you know about the Never people.
Yeah.
And the legend of Zagreus. So,
which
involves Rassilon. So once again, Time Lord.
Yeah, which another thing that they have in here is, as in addition to the on-screen actors, they have a bunch who were kind of established in Big Finish at this point. So Conrad Westmus, who played Kariz, Caroline Morris, who was Aramem, Maggie Stables, who's Evelyn Smythe, who I adore, Robert Jessick, I believe he played Frobisher, the Penguin. Well, he was a shapeshifter who liked to be a penguin.
Yeah.
And then Lisa Bowerman, who played Bernice Summerfield, among others, but mostly Bernice Summerfield. So yeah, so they got some of their Big Finish. So their Big Finish veterans, I guess, which is fun because, you know, it's like, it's cool when Big Finish characters get lumped in with the TV ones too.
So, and then there's a half hour making of documentary. It's an audio, it's not visual, but it's an audio documentary that's tied to I don't think it's officially a short trip, but it's an Eighth Doctor and Charlie like short story called Living Legend that was available for free at one point from Big Finish. I don't know if it still is. But it has the documentary on it. Because I listened actually to that early October, so not that long ago, and then listened to the Zagreus documentary. And it's funny because this is 2003, and they're talking in this documentary. It's hosted by Sophie Aldred. But talking to, you know, the doctors and the former companions and stuff and, you know, Nicholas Briggs and all that. And like, oh, yeah, you know, it's like, you know, we couldn't let the 40th anniversary of Doctor Who go by, you know, without anything. It's like, because, you know, the show's not on right now. And I'm like, 2 years later, it will be.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I think
no at the time.
And at this point, they probably if it hadn't been announced yet, they were definitely in talks to bring it back.
Oh, I'm sure, probably.
Yeah.
Yeah. But Zagreus, it's a really good audio, but it is just, it's weird.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. That is true. I mean, But like Rachel said, do not make this your first Big Finish.
Yeah, no.
Because you will definitely be not. Confused.
It's like, don't even make it your second or third or fourth Big Finish. Like, this was probably within like the first like 10 Big Finishes I ever listened to. And I think even then it was still too early, to be honest with you.
Honestly, my recommendation with Big Finish is start with number one of the main range and go from there.
That's what I've done.
There was also a book released then called Deadly Reunion, which is I'll read you the synopsis. With one glance, he will destroy your body and wither your soul. Second Lieutenant Lethbridge Stewart gets more than he bargained for when he is assigned to map out Greek islands at the end of the Second World War. Even if he lives to tell the tale, will he remember it? Years later, Brigadier Lethbridge Stewart and his colleagues at UNIT investigate a spate of unexplained deaths and murders. Meanwhile, Third Doctor and Joe are caught up in strange events in the small English village of Hobbs Haven. As preparations get underway for a massive pop concert, a sinister cult prepares for a day of reckoning. business as usual for Unit, but can the Brigadier help prevent the end of the world? His friends and colleagues are not so sure, because this time the Brigadier has fallen in love.
Okay.
Yep.
You know, that kind of tallies with some of the novels written around this time, because some of the plots, some of the summaries are just bat crap.
Yeah.
Sorry. I mean, I know they were like, oh, we need to write them so they're more mature, because the people who grew up with Doctor Who are adults now. And I'm like, I think your definition of mature and my definition of mature differ greatly.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, this was written by Barry Letts, who was a producer on Doctor Who, and Terrence Dix, who was a script editor. Apparently, Letts writes the first part of it, the bits where he's second lieutenant Lethbridge Stewart, and then Terrence Dix writes the modern, quote-unquote modern part of it. And according to the article, apparently the second half of the story, which is the modern part, is essentially just a rewrite of the demons. So
okay.
So take that as you will. And then the 45th anniversary, we get a release from Big Finish called 45. And I can read the synopsis for it. In Egypt, archaeologist Howard Carter unearths an ancient secret buried in the Valley of the Kings on an island of Mendelovina. I don't know. A deranged academic attempts to push back the frontiers of the human mind. In war-torn London, a Cockney spiv takes possession of a bizarre alien object. And in a military bunker in the cold heart of Antarctica, the strangest and deadliest of the Doctor's many enemies lies in wait. That's the synopsis. It's the Seventh Doctor and Ace and Hex is a Big Finish companion.
Yep. I have this one queued up on my in my Big Finish queue, listening. Yeah. I haven't got there yet.
Yeah, it's supposed to be good. If anything else, the archaeologist is voiced by Benedict Cumberbatch.
Ooh, nice.
Something to look forward to when I get there.
Yep.
I didn't realize this one was an anniversary special.
It's not. Of sorts. It's kind of like Remembrance of the Daleks, where it's like, it's not officially, but it's good, and it was released right around the same time, so we're going to go with it.
And 45, so, yeah.
Yeah. So. And by then, the show was back, so they probably weren't, you know, looking to
make a big deal out of it.
Make a big deal about it, so. And that takes us to 6 years ago, as of this last Saturday, for the 50th anniversary, which really is a whole bunch of stuff.
Yes.
I mean, obviously, we've got the Day of the Doctor, but really, it was just one big old celebration.
Mm-hmm. Basically, we partied for a month.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, pretty much.
Yeah. I guess maybe for the whole year, but I just remember, because Big Finish released Light at the End, and I had pre-ordered it.
Yeah. Well, they ended up releasing it a month yeah. sooner than they were planning to. Yeah, it ended up going to the end of October.
Yeah. They didn't want it to get lost with all the 50th anniversary stuff. And they're like, well, it's ready, so just go. And it was actually kind of a surprise, because all of us who pre-ordered, it's like, oh, well, there. And we got emails and said, oh, it's ready. Well, okay then. And, you know, pop it in. And
It's very good. Yeah, the light at the end. That's one that it's like I just started listening to Big Finish not that long before. So when they announced this and released it, I'm like, yes, please, thank you. Even if I'm not really listening to much Big Finish, it's like big multi Doctor story anniversary and thing. Yes, please.
Yeah, and it's
gimme.
It's written to where a newbie could understand it.
Yeah.
Pretty much, or you know, I mean, if you don't get all the references, that's okay. It's a good story in its own right.
Yeah. It's a big multi-doctor story with a master.
Yep.
So it's kind of, it's pretty straightforward, actually. So
yeah, and the story is simple, but all the doctors and companions all get something to do. There's cameos from some of the earlier ones. They managed to get the first, second, and third in there with, you know, voice sound alikes and some sound trickery. And it's just, I mean, I was listening to it over the weekend because it's like, oh, I love this one. And it just feels like, I was like, the thought in my mind came, it's comfort food.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, I could listen to this anytime and just kind of feel just happy.
Yeah.
Like, I love this. I love this stuff. It's so great. And they're having fun, and it reminds me of a really good time, you know, that month of the 50th anniversary. It's like, oh man, it was just so much fun, and I enjoyed it, and yeah, it was just, it's warm fuzzies all around.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the first and so far only physical Big Finish I own.
It's a nice physical release too, though.
It is.
Yeah, especially if you got like the premium release, or came with like all this like extra book stuff and
yep.
Yeah, I kind of wish I had gotten it.
The pre-order came around. I remember the pre-order started around my birthday, so I had a little extra birthday money. So I'm like, yes, that's what I'm spending it
on. Yeah, that I was like grabby hands with that one. So, but we were all kind of grabby hands just for like that, and like from that release through the end of November.
So. Yeah, it was like, I will take that. I will take that. You're going to give me this? Sure. Just back up my truck and just load me up. Come on.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Grabby hands.
Yeah. Yeah. So then the weeks, heck, months leading up to the 50th, because like the first, because they started filming in April of 2013, and we really did not know a whole lot other than it was going to be Matt Smith, who was the doctor at the time. David Tennant would be returning, and so would Billy Piper in some capacity, but that's all we really knew.
They had announced John Hurt was going to be in it.
Yes.
But I mean, but they didn't say like what he, like who he was going to be. And they announced the lady who played Elizabeth and
we so it's like, really, oh,
they're
know.
Just, yeah, there's just extra cast. And then, the end of whatever season.
The name of the, doctor.
And then it's like, hey, here's John Hurt playing the not doctor. Like, what?
Yeah. even in the name of the doctor, though, the little lettering they put up there is like introducing John Hurt as the doctor.
Yeah.
At that time. So, and that was in May. And we're all like, what? We're like, we have to wait till November. What the heck? And then, like they showed a trailer or something at San Diego Comic-Con, I believe, and this probably wouldn't happen again, but somehow, as much as people like to complain about Stephen Moffat, somehow Stephen Moffat was able to convince all those people at San Diego Comic-Con to not release a damn thing.
I remember,
if anything gets out, you aren't getting anything until the 23rd, essentially.
Yes, and I remember people in the UK were so mad that America got the trailer first. We're all like, excuse us, that was like a room full of people in San Diego. It wasn't all of America, so just chill, man.
Yeah.
It's like, you just keep your mouth shut.
Yeah. But then as we got closer, we'd get more, you know, they'd start the marketing campaign with the hashtag save the day. And we get like these, like we got like this, it wasn't a trailer, but it was like this teaser thing, but it was just like images and sounds from the 50 years of Doctor Who. And there were some like Easter eggs for the special coming, but we didn't know what they meant because we hadn't seen it yet, so we didn't have context. And then we got an actual trailer like a week before or something like that. It was really close to, you know, release day before we finally actually got to see like any actual footage from it. But then before that, like a week or so before, or a couple weeks before, they decided to give us a carrot, I guess, to appease the, you know, mob with the pitchfork by bringing back Paul McGann.
Yeah, this was actually on his birthday. I remember this. Yeah.
Finally, yes. Giving him the regeneration that we never got to see with the short, The Night of the Doctor.
Which, and that was,
lost our collective minds.
I applaud.
with the surprise in joy with no context whatsoever. I'm just like,
yes.
Mm-hmm. What?
And it's like DBC, you cheeky little trolls. They're just like, here, have this little short, and we're like, oh, okay, and sure, this, whatever. Yeah. I think the teaser image.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I woke up, and like, I got like someone tweeted something. One of you guys, I think. And it was like,
I was posting all over the place. And like by that point, like we were all like Facebook friends.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think I was the first one up and online just because of like the time zones and stuff. So like I was like tagging all of you. So hopefully you saw that before anything else.
I'm like, go watch this right now
before you click on anything else. You don't want to get spoiled.
Yeah, it was something like that. Because I mean, my time zone's 2 hours behind you and an hour behind the boys.
At the time, I was in New Mexico, so I was with you, Christy.
Yeah, and I was like, half awake. I'm like, hey, what is this on my phone? Okay, I'll watch it, whatever. And
I'm a doctor, but not the one you were expecting.
And I just heard
that voice. I'm just like,
at that point, I was wide awake. I sat straight up and was like, what?
Back it up.
Excuse me? What is this?
Yep.
And what? You got who? Huh?
I'm not dreaming, am I?
Oh my gosh. That whole day, I was just like, I couldn't get off the internet.
Mm-hmm. Like, I mean, I was basically pretty much doing Paul McGann's Eighth Doctor shoe dance.
Yes. And I went to work later that evening, and I was useless. I didn't care.
Yeah,
nobody can ruin my day. Paul McGann's back as the doctor, and some of the companions make finish got canonized.
Yes.
I was like, I don't care. The 50th anniversary special can be complete and utter crap. I got this.
It's like, mm-hmm. We've got Paul McGann back as a doctor. He's gotten regeneration, so we know how this fits into the timeline. Mm-hmm. And they made Big Finish canon.
Yep.
I was like, from here on out, Big Finish is canon.
Yeah. And it's like, and it doesn't even matter that they'll probably add companions to the Eighth Doctor's run or anything. It's like, nope, it's there. Mm-hmm. We got Charlie, we got Lucy, we got Karis, we got Tamsin, and Molly. Molly was at that point. Yeah. But yes, it was like, oh boy.
Yeah. I'm getting goosebumps just thinking about it.
I know, right?
It's done so well. It's like 6 minutes and change, and they did it. And so like the doctor, when he gets, you know, temporarily revived by the sister in a car, and she's like, you've got a little under 4 minutes left. That's literally how much is left in the bit. Is 4 minutes.
Like they pulled a 24.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Bring me knitting.
And it's like, bring me knitting. Yes. That's ages. Oh, it's just so much fun. And then the very next Salt Lake Comic Con, Paul McGann and Colin Baker, they were both there, but Paul McGann was there. And I, you know, I brought it up to him. I'm like, oh, we're so happy to see you in Night of the Doctor. And he was like, oh, yes, wasn't that great? And I was like, wasn't it great? It was on your birthday. And he was like, yeah. It was just, I mean, if you've ever met Paul McGann, he's kind of unassuming and kind of quiet, but he kind of grinned when I said that. And I was like, I just remember that. It was a good time.
Yeah.
Best birthday present ever.
So it's like you get that, and then there's a tiny little prequel pre-story short thing called The Last Day, which is from the perspective of a Gallifreyan soldier on their first day. And you see what happens when the Daleks break the sky trenches and when Arcadia falls. So we get that that short little, but that it works as a precursor, but also the soldier in that short who is training the rookie soldier is the same soldier that the war doctor later takes the gun from to shoot no more into the wall.
So there's some. That wasn't as earth-shattering as Night of the Doctor, but I think if they tried to do that again, if they tried to blow our minds again, I think we would have been mush.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, and then
we need to keep them alive for the 50th.
And then we get the special proper itself, the Day of the Doctor, which, oh my God, I love, I just, like, in my notes, I just wrote in big letters, I love this story. Mm-hmm. Like, I can watch this one over and over and over and over, and I have. Mm-hmm. But I just love this story. It's just so, so, so good.
Yeah. It's like, I mean, we've talked about all these different anniversary specials to this point, and you know, the five doctors, I joked like, hey, you know, we're just gonna throw them all together and play in the sandbox, and they, you know, that one works for that one, but they didn't want to, I mean, they didn't necessarily want to do that for this because it would kind of be hard to do anyway, but I just remember like Stephen Moffat talking about in a lot of interviews, he's like, well, yeah, we're celebrating the 50th anniversary, but we want to set up for, you know, what's to come. Or, you know, to set up more story for the Doctor in the future. And, you know, when we were talking about the three Doctors, how up until that point, the third Doctor had been earthbound. And then at the end of that story, he gets the time circuit back to so he can, you know, go in the TARDIS. So it's like they did kind of the same thing at the end there, just on a little smaller scale. But, you know, now it's like, okay, he actually saved Gallifrey and now he's got to go look for it. And so, you know, we're setting up what we're going to be doing for the next little while, at least.
Yeah. Well, this is the anniversary special you get when, one, you've got a decent budget.
Yes.
You've got, you know, people in charge that actually, you know, Stephen Moffat was a fan and had been a fan for a long time. I mean, this is, you know, yeah, you get someone who's a fan and understands the history and the significance and what came before and where the show is going also to, and realizes that, you know, 50 years is a big deal. And it's like, if you're going to do it, it's not taking your toy box, it's not taking the toy store, it is taking the entire universe and dumping it in the sandbox and going, I'm going to use as much of this as possible, but in a way that makes sense. Unlike previous anniversary specials where, yeah, you could find ways to justify having multiple doctors together, but it's like, how do you figure out the companions? Mm-hmm. You want to make sure to, you know, make sure that they're recognized too in a way that makes sense. And they did you know, by involving Unit again, because Unit, you know, you got the Doctor's history, Gallifrey and lore, and Unit seem to be like the three tent poles of anniversary specials for a good chunk of them. You know, able to canonize things and then also, you know, clarify things that maybe had not been clear from the past. It's just, you can tell it's written by someone who knows what he was working with. It's like the difference between having like me try to cook you something in the kitchen and having like a master chef make you something in the kitchen. So. And of course they still blew our minds. I mean, just with all the Easter eggs, among other things. Yeah, you go into the Black Archive, which is still a thing that gets referenced. I was just doing a recording episode of the Social Sci-Fi podcast, and we did Resolution, and you see the Black Archive mentioned on the computer screen in that episode. So it's like, hey, that's a thing. So, you know, you've got all these like physical Easter eggs, you know, River Song's high-heeled shoes, you know, the Magna clamps from Doomsday, you know, when Kate Stewart's talking about how all the Doctor's companions have to be, fully vetted, and they've got that board, and it's not just the, you know, there's the obvious companions, like we see Susan, you know, we see Sarah Jane and Jamie, but you also get, you know, they made sure to include a lot of characters that you may not necessarily recognize at first glance.
And some of them you're like, did they ever go to Earth? I don't know. I can't remember. But, you know, it's like, or, you know, did they ever go to Earth where Unit would be able to get a picture of them or something like that? But, yeah, if you're going to do those Easter eggs, like something like the Black Archive is a good way to get that stuff in there. Mm-hmm. And they, you know, and they go to town.
Yeah.
I mean, even I was watching it earlier. I was watching Day of the Doctor earlier, and I was, like, trying to stop and look, and I couldn't catch all the pictures. Who was on that board?
Yeah. Well, according to, I don't know if I got this off IMDb or elsewhere, but the photos on the board include Susan, Mike Yates, Sarah Kingdom, Polly, Dodo, Zoe, Harry Sullivan, Sergeant Benton, Sarah Jane, K9 Mark III, Barbara, Ian, Ben, Jamie. Obviously the Brigadier, Leela, Vicky, Victoria, Joe, Liz Shaw, Romana 2, Stephen Taylor, Katarina, Romana 1, Tegan, Nyssa, Grace, Donna, Amy, Clara, obviously, Adric, Chameleon, Rose, Wilfred, Perry, some other Unit people, Unit Captain Arisa Magbo? I don't know who that is. Brigadier Winifred Bambera, Ace, Martha, Mickey, Adam, Rory, Turlo, Mel, Jack, Craig, and River. So that's a lot.
I almost want a side story with Kate Stewart and River Song.
Yeah,
because apparently they're in the same picture, so they must have been there together.
Yeah. Well, and then there's like some details about the some of the companions too, like Ace's full name, what house on Gallifrey Romana is from, the fact that Romana 2 becomes president of Gallifrey. Barbara apparently wrote a textbook called Journeys Through History, a source book for GCSE for the Associated Exam Board.
So yeah, and then like all these little references, they are from, you know, the audios and some of the books. So, you know, making all that stuff canon.
Mm-hmm.
Continuing that grand tradition.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And yeah, the fact that, you know, when Stephen Moffat wrote this, well, when he originally wrote it, it was supposed to be the ninth Doctor, so he was hoping that Christopher Eccleston would return, along with David Tennant and Matt Smith. And then Chris was, he didn't, I guess apparently he didn't say no right away, but they just could not come up with, you know, something that he would agree to, so he ended up walking away from it. So then he had to change the story and come up with this incarnation of the Doctor that we didn't know about, the War Doctor.
Which, you know, brought in, there are worse ways to fix that. And getting John Hurt is like...
Yeah. And apparently John Hurt, they just asked him. He didn't have to audition. They asked. He said yes. Which, can you blame him?
Nope.
So, and he was amazing. Absolutely amazing choice for the War Doctor. Just, oh, yes. Ugh. He just, I watched it again earlier, and the bit towards the end after he's seen his future and the man he's going to become, and he goes back with the moment, and he's got the big red button, and the two doctors, you know, show up and realize that, you know, he hasn't done it yet, and he's like, you know, go be the doctor I couldn't be, and just the gravel in his voice and the look of, ugh. It makes me want to cry. It's so beautiful. It's absolutely beautiful.
And then at the end, like after everything's happened and they're in the art gallery with all the TARDISes drinking tea. Mm-hmm. And you know, 10 and 11 are like calling him doctor and everything. And he just has this bright smile on his face, and like his eyes light up, and he looks, you know, it looks like the War Doctor's just had centuries just drop off of him. Mm-hmm. And he looks like he's just going to be, you know, that sweet, carefree doctor that this incarnation ought to have been. And I'm like, oh, you are so sweet, and I want to hug you.
Mm-hmm.
Getting used to his future reincarnations, because when he first met them, he's just like, seriously?
You're me?
Am I going through a midlife crisis?
You're beyond midlife, Air Doctor. You're running out of generations.
It's like, yeah, we're gonna deal with that in the next one, but
yeah. Hey, you and we were talking about how, you know, the night of the Doctor blew our minds, and like, you know, the last day wasn't anything mind blowing because, like, heaven forbid they blow our minds again. And then they still manage to blow our minds with this, not once, but twice,
mm-hmm.
with all the doctors converging on Gallifrey to try and save it from the Daleks. Mm-hmm. And at this point, they, you know, even back when Moffat started writing it, they knew Matt Smith was leaving, but the new doctor had not been cast yet. But he would have mm-hmm. wrote the sequence of all the doctors coming to save Gallifrey, not knowing who it was going to be at the point. But by this point, we all knew Matt was leaving. We knew who the new doctor was. So then we get this sequence of all the doctors using this archive footage coming to save Gallifrey. And we get that line from the one high commander or whatever, and essentially using the Brigadier's line from previous anniversary uh-huh. stories where I didn't know I was well off.
Another one.
Are you sure the message is from him?
Oh, yes.
Why would he do that? What's the mad fool talking about now?
Hello, hello. Gallifrey High Command. This is the Doctor speaking.
Hello, also the Doctor. Can you hear me?
Also the Doctor. Standing ready.
Dear God, three of them. All my worst nightmares at once.
General, we have a plan.
We should point out at this moment it is a fairly terrible plan.
And almost certainly won't work. I was happy with fairly terrible. Sorry, just thinking out loud.
We're flying our three TARDISes into your lower atmosphere.
We're positioned at equidistant intervals around the globe.
Equidistant, so grown up.
Just about ready to do it.
Ready to do what?
We're going to freeze Gallifrey.
I'm sorry, what?
Using our TARDISes, we're going to freeze Gallifrey in a single moment in time.
You know, like those stasis cubes? A single moment in time held in a parallel pocket universe.
Except we're going to do it to a whole planet.
And all the people on it.
What? Even if that were possible.
Which it isn't. Why would you do such a thing?
Because the alternative is burning. And I've seen that. And I never want to see it again.
We'd be lost in another universe. Frozen in a single moment. We'd have nothing.
You would have hope. And right now, that is exactly what you don't have.
It's delusional. The calculations alone would take hundreds of years.
Oh, hundreds and hundreds, but don't worry. I started a very long time ago.
Calling the War Council of Gallifrey. This is the Doctor.
You might say, I've been doing this all my lives.
Good luck.
Stand by.
Ready. Commencing calculation.
Zoom me there.
Across the boundaries that divide one universe from another.
Got to lock onto his coordinates. And for my next trick, I didn't know when I was well off. All 12 of them. No, sir. Ah! All 13! Sir, ah! The Daleks know that something is happening. They're increasing their firepower. Do it, Doctor. Just do it. Do it.
Okay.
Gentlemen, we're ready.
Geronimo!
For God's sake, Gallifrey, stand!
And he was like, 12 of them. I didn't know when I was well off. And his assistant or whatever was like, no, sir, all 13. And we just get this shot of Peter Capaldi's eyes and the eyebrows. The group I was in, everybody lost their crap.
I mean, that scene was awesome as it was, like, even if they hadn't thrown that in there. And then by then, I was just like, goodbye, everybody.
Yep.
We're done.
Thanks, bro.
I'm gone.
Yeah. It's like, you know, it's like, ah, we're dead. And then they go in, like, you know. We don't know whether they actually saved Gallifrey or not. And we get the, you know, beautiful goodbye, like Chrissy was saying, with the war doctor finally realizing that he can call himself the Doctor, that he does deserve that title. And then we get, I think at this point it was not as big a surprise because it kind of been leaked by the man himself, but... You hear Tom Baker's voice before you see him, and even now, 6 years later, the minute I hear him say, you know, I rather think you might, it just chills. I get chills hearing Tom's voice. Like, oh, here he comes, the great curator. Like, oh, wonderful moment between him and Matt Smith's Doctor, and it's very meta in a way. You know, it's like, if I were you, or maybe you're me.
And some of that I have to wonder, like, did Tom ad lib, like when he says congratulations? I'm like okay. I mean Tom's kind of quirky in that way.
Yeah.
And that's something he would do, but oh yeah, it's fun to watch. It is it's just great. And then to have him be the one to say, you know, Gallifrey's fine.
Yeah,
or you know, however he says it, and they're like, "You saved him. Yeah. You saved Gallifrey."
Like, where is it? He's like, lost. Yeah, it's and eventually we do get Gallifrey back during Capaldi's run. So, and hopefully they'll do something with that going forward. But that, I mean, them being able to essentially, because what they did when Doctor Who came back in 2005, because they didn't necessarily want to repeat what they had done previously and, you know, be able to expand and do other things, is it's really just kind of an offhanded
comment from the Ninth Doctor about, you know, there was a war, mm-hmm. and his home was destroyed in the war, and that's why we're only getting the Doctor and not any other Time Lords or ladies or any other Gallifreyans, so that you know, that cut that off for a while, so it allowed them to explore other aspects of what they could do with Doctor Who without having to constantly go back to Gallifrey or having the Time Lords intervene like they do, even though they're not supposed to do anything. They're only supposed to watch, but they still like to stick their fingers in things. Mm-hmm. But to be able to figure out a way to essentially retcon that in a way that totally makes sense and know that, you know, Gallifrey is still out there and now the Doctor has found it. But it's like, at this point, they're not necessarily interfering. So other than the fact that they gave him a whole new lump of regenerations. So, which is how we got Capaldi's Doctor in the first place.
Although that was kind of, I kind of see that as, that was a thank you.
Yeah.
It's like, you saved us, now we're going to save you. It's like, good! Yeah. After Clara begged him, but, you know.
Yeah.
That's another story.
Yeah. Pretentious Time Lords! That's a topic for a whole other episode.
Exactly. Yep. It's like you make us feel sorry for them, especially, I mean, going the angle of, you know, the kids, because, you know, the kids have nothing to do with any of this, and it's,
mm-hmm.
and all that, and but, you know, the ones in charge are all like, sometimes you guys need to be, you guys need a smack across the face. Mm-hmm. But anyway, that's neither here nor there. It's a great special and it's a great story. And it's, you know, it's a fitting anniversary story and very well done. And it's great. It's wonderful. And we love it. And we, you know, we all had to kind of pick ourselves up off of the floor and be like, did you see, fangirl mm-hmm. out.
Yeah. Oh, on the rewatchability.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. 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 It's definitely one of those where it's like, I can rewatch it anytime.
Mm-hmm.
And be a happy camper.
So, oh, yes.
It's just, it's good Doctor Who.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I guess that was kind of the goal.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, just kind of as a coda to the entire, all the celebrations later that night, we got the Five-ish Doctors reboot, mm-hmm. which kind of served as dessert, or kind of a palate cleanser, like kind of helped us with the come down of the high of all this stuff. And then, you know,
the after dinner mint.
It's like, I need to mellow out. And then we had this little comical farce, I guess, but it was so well done and done with love, and
and gave us our name
doing it. Yes.
Yep.
bless Peter Davison for starting it, and then it just, you know, the BBC, you know, Stephen Moffat and the BBC got involved, and it snowballed from there. And I'm like, you know what? That was just perfect. That was what we needed to close it out.
Yeah. Oh, it's like when I saw Sylvester McCoy the following year. The very first PopCon, you know, and we hadn't launched yet, but we were doing all the back end stuff for the podcast, and I told mm-hmm. him what it was called, and he totally got the reference.
Same thing. I saw Colin Baker the next year, and I was like, yeah, we have a podcast. We named it after the Five-ish Doctors or the Five-ish Fangirls, and he laughed. I was like, you love our thing. That makes me happy.
Yeah. It's a wonderful, like, spoof, you know, farce type thing, kind of just poking fun at, you know.
Oh, especially the scene with Barrowman.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
gosh. And you have to know that.
Driving a minivan with the full of kids and a wife.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you have to know that John Barrowman just ate that up, I'm sure. Oh,
yeah. And ran with it.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. It's like the 50th anniversary. It's like it was like a buffet. It wasn't just a single special or a special and a big finish audio. Like, it was a full meal.
Yeah.
For the 50th.
And honestly, because earlier in the year, people were like, well, how come we're not going to do a multi-doctor? How come you're not getting all these people? It's like, how could one special really do a 50th anniversary justice. I mean, we got we got the Day of the Doctor, sure. We also got Adventure in Space and Time. We got Light at the End. We got Night of the Doctor. We got the announcement of a new Doctor. And then the Five-ish Doctors reboot. Like, you had to have all these little things to kind of pay tribute to all different facets of Doctor Who. We also had, you know, the was it Destiny of the Doctor? It was like an audio series. Mm-hmm. They had some, like, the books that came out. There was a comic series. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then BBC America's having all the big countdowns with.
Yeah.
With all the Doctor retrospectives, they talked about their stories and they would air what they considered the best story for each Doctor on the BBC,
and then the Doctors revisited. So it was like you couldn't just do one thing and say, okay, yep, that's our 50th anniversary. Like, no, you had to, you know, and it wasn't like it was a coordinated effort because. I was listening to Light at the End, the behind the scenes stuff, and Nick Briggs is talking like he didn't want to do a multi doctor, he didn't really want to do an anniversary thing, but as it got closer, and some of the people at Big Finish were saying, well, shouldn't we do something? And he was like, oh well, yeah, let's do something, and then they just kind of pulled it all together. So, you know, it wasn't like someone from on high, the BBC, saying, okay, you do this, you do this, you do that. It was like all these different. Not really departments, but all these different parties, I guess, saying we want to do something, and they went and did it.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just, it was like you said, it was a buffet, it was a feast. Mm-hmm. And you know, I think back on that time in 2013, I'm like, that was just so much fun. I don't think it'll ever happen again. But every time I go back and watch one of these, or read the books, or the comics, or listen to the audio, I'm just, it's just, it's sort of a weird. I mean, it's only been 6 years. But I kind of feel nostalgic for that time, and I kind of miss it sometimes, just because it felt, you know, it kind of felt like everybody was just happy and celebratory and having a good time with it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, can we go back and do that again somehow? I don't know how you do it, but it was so fun.
Yeah. Good times.
Always. Oh. Well. Anyway. Did we exhaust everybody?
I think so. I mean, that was a lot. Like I said, I don't know if people necessarily realize just how much. I mean, most people, if they know, you know, the TV series and know Classic Who, they're like, oh yeah, the Three Doctors, the Five Doctors. You know, maybe the Silver Nemesis, and then they're like, oh yeah, the 50th anniversary special. And it's like, no, there is way more than that.
So. I guess if there's one thing Doctor Who fans know how to do, it's party.
Yeah.
And generate find a reason to party.
Yeah. But. If you don't have anything Doctor Who to consume, you're doing it wrong.
It's like, here, let me help.
Find something.
Let me help you out. I will share.
Yep.
Anyway, well, if any of our listeners want to chime in with their thoughts on any of these anniversary specials, like I said, there's so many, and some of them we didn't get around to watching or listening to. So if you have and want to send us your thoughts on any of this, send us feedback at fiveishfangirls@gmail.com. You can also go to our website, which is thefiveishfangirls.com, and find links to all of our social media. You can like us on Facebook, and we have Instagram and YouTube, and we will often read out comments that are left there as feedback as well. You can also download us wherever you find podcasts: Apple Podcasts, Google Play, Spotify. We're pretty much everywhere where you can listen to us. And also, just as a little minor plug. With this Friday being Black Friday, if you go to our Amazon store through our website, we have a link to it. And if you go to Amazon through our store, we get a little cut of whatever you buy, like a referral bonus. You don't have to spend anything extra. But if you're doing any online Black Friday shopping or Cyber Monday or whatever coming up, just remember us. That helps support the podcast. And as well, we also have Patreon and our merch shop. So, and you know, a big thank you to all of our supporters. I know I say it every week, and it does. I mean it. I don't mean it to just be repetitive and mm-hmm. not, because it really does help, and you guys are great. Yeah. Whatever. Yeah. And however you support us, whether you're sending money or commenting, feedback, whatever, we thank you and we love you. And mm-hmm. high fives, fist bumps all around.
As Thanksgiving is later this week, I think we can all say that we are thankful for all of our listeners and supporters.
Yes. Yes. Absolutely.
All right, so with that, we shall sign off for this week.
This is Brittany and Bethlehem saying goodnight.
This is Chrissy saying goodnight and stay warm from Salt Lake City.
This is Holly from Wisconsin saying good evening.
And this is Rachel in Indianapolis, Indiana. Make sure to wear your stretchy pants on Thursday.
Listening to the Five-ish Fangirls podcast. You can find more episodes and information at thefiveishfangirls.com. Any and all books, movies, games, and any other forms of media mentioned are owned and operated by the respective copyright holders. No copyright infringement is intended or implied. If you wish to support the show, the easiest way is to leave us a rating and review. More ratings and reviews will make it easier for others to find the show. If you wish to support us monetarily, you can do so at patreon.com/fiveishfangirlspodcast. All money goes towards fees and equipment to keep the show going. For official Five-ish Fangirls merchandise, visit redbubble.com/people/fiveishfangirls. We love hearing from our listeners and encourage feedback. You can email us at fiveishfangirls@gmail.com. You can also like and follow us on Facebook at facebook.com/fiveishfangirls. Thank you so much for listening, and may the squee be with you.
Yeah. doctors with companions at their side.